fight, I ain't good with a doom. As in a fish that I build and I pissed, and now he can't even sue. My papers are dying and I make every time, and now I think I'm a man. I remember the guy that I used to slam. I'm the man, oh yes I am.
First started together, me, Bob and Dave.
That's right, yeah.
We actually started in the living room of my parents' house.
Six.
Me playing the drums on a poofay.
Yeah, the, it's like a piece of paper and the poofay.
That's
yeah,
it.
Was that, like snare and hi-hat.
Snare and hi-hat.
So we'd be around at his house listening to probably a lot of Dr. Feelgood, Heavy Metal Kids, who Bob really adored, and so did I. The Who, another band that we obviously bonded over. Sensational Alex Harvey Band is another band that springs to mind. And they're all the bands, look at the vocalists in those bands, or the front men in those bands, and they are Bob's influences.
And then, in terms of playing, me and Bob actually learnt to play as we rehearsed. So it was Bob on bass originally, just as a three-piece.
Yeah.
And then as time went on, Bob being Bob, he found that the bass guitar restricted him. He wanted to sort of,
yeah,
as he was singing and playing bass, but he wanted to sort of let rip.
Jock then re-engaged with Bob and started rehearsing at the Old Prairie Youth Club, or above the Old Prairie Youth Club on Nunnery Lane.
We did a few covers. There was AC/DC, UFO and ZZ Top.
That's right, yeah.
But the rest of it was all our own. It was all pretty high energy stuff. First gig was Nunthorpe School. Bobby gone to Bulmers to get an old cheap acoustic guitar, which he brought along. And during the set, he smashed it on the stage. So he started as he meant to go on, did Bob.
I first saw Cyanide in 1976, it was at Nunthorpe School Hall. They weren't quite a punk band at that time, they were still doing covers and stuff like that, but they had all the elements of what was about to become punk, in that they were very loud, they were very tight, and they were very fast.
And I think it was February 76, I spotted that famous first review of the Sex Pistols in the NME. It said something like, "Don't look over your shoulder because the Sex Pistols are coming."
Jock came in and said, "Get down to the car and listen to this tape I've made." And we got in his car, in the car park there, and he put it on and it was Anarchy. We all looked at each other and thought,
yeah,
bloody hell, this is what we're about, you know.
Kick ass rock, after two! One, two!
So
So the first gig at the Grobs, we actually carried all our equipment from Old Barry U Club on Nunnery Lane, and we carried it down Toft Green to the Grob and Ducky.
A terror looks in corners. It tries to steal.
It sat up in the corner of this room, probably 4 foot by 4 foot, all of them crammed in together, surrounded by the audience. And so Bob would be like, here singing, the audience would be here, so right in your face like this.
That this band called Cyanide were playing the Grob and Ducky, and we went along to see what it was about, and I was like, yes, I like this. Immediately, I was just like, whoa, this punk thing sounds brilliant, you know. I mean, they had their own dance, they were jumping up and down, and I like, what? This is just amazing.
Now it's your race, it's in my hometown band. Then I see it in my favorite bar, and then when you say when you ask me to wait, or when I tell you.
Two massive gigs at the Cats Whiskers in June. Firstly with Wayne County's Electric Chairs.
Greg Van Cook and I both had unusual looking Les Paul, 1957 Les Paul Custom, and the pickups were like, you know, quite unique and everything. So a weekend we went on, and then Greg Van Cook was in the audience and he thought, he's nicked my guitar. So he had to go up to the dressing room to check, and he saw his was there, like, he thought I pinched his guitar.
And that was then followed shortly after that by support with a jam at the Cats Whiskers too, where in my mind at least, at the time I blew them off stage.
So I think the problem there was that they didn't realise we were a York band, and we went down really well and it freaked them out. We were playing with them on later on that tour of theirs at Middlesbrough Town Hall, and we couldn't use back the fallback. I couldn't use the drum mics. We had to get our PA in from the van, and the only way we knew Bob was singing was we had to stand sideways, because we just could not hear a thing in such a big hall. So later on, after they'd played, some girls came backstage for their autographs, and Weller was really offhand and rude to them, and Bob was just seething. And that was a straw that broke the camel's back. Next thing, it was Weller, Bob had Weller by the throat up against the wall with his feet inches off the floor, his little legs going, and turning purple, and Bob made him apologise to these girls. So. Strangely, we were invited to join them on any more gigs on that tour. We did a gig with XTC there. They were great.
That's right, they were great, yeah.
And we actually played with, supported the Damned.
And Rathskabies went into the dressing room, Sana's dressing room, before the gig. And he said, he was a sport band, and I went, yeah, who's the drummer? And he pointed to Mike. And he goes, oh, can you use this? And handed him a cymbal that had a crack in it. How great was that, you know? He didn't have to do that.
I first saw them, I think, at the Munster Bar. Now, the Munster Bar was a bit of a sleazy joint with strippers during the week. It's dangerous down there. There was a sort of dark danger feeling in the Munster Bar. Anyway, the band came on, and what really struck me, and I suddenly got it, and I got the humour in punk and the taking the piss in punk, was when they did Matt the Flash. Bob came on with his eyes staring and opening his raincoat with some, with a, I think it was a stoat.
It was a grey squirrel in actual fact. They used to always call it the ferret. And I just thought, because I was a taxidermist, I could probably make him something. I made this phallic ornament for Bob to wear. And it works, I think it works really well, you know, when it would always shock and make people laugh when that came out. They used to do a version of Johnny Be Good, changed to Albert Be Bad, because Albert, Mad Albert, used to come to Cyanide gigs. Okay! The things I remember about going down to London with Cyanide was there was a coach load of us going down there. I think Nev got some good photographs of the gap when we stopped at motorway service station. They were supporting Screwdriver. There was two punk girls there. They both had dog collars on, but one had a lead and she was dragging the other one around on this lead.
You know, gigs were very different. There was often a palpable kind of sense of tension and danger in the air.
So me and Steph Rams went to Scarborough. Cyanide went on first, and that we could hear the Burlock chanting, York. It was just oppressive, and I remember Dave getting his leg slashed and saying to me, something's happened to my leg, and it was actually slashed through his jeans.
It was at Scarborough Penthouse, where we had round two of the battle with the Scrotes from Middlesbrough. I still got the scar on my shin from getting razored on stage when I jumped up to sing along a Bob. When you're in front of a crowd fueled by the three A's, you know, anger, amphetamine and alcohol, you'd better get it right.
The official line was that, the line that was put out there was that an executive from Pi Records stopped off in York for a pint on his way down to London, and just happened to walk into the grub, saw Cyanide playing, and signed them on the spot. But it didn't happen like that.
A producer actually came up to York to see us at the Grobs. So he came up and liked it all, so that's where the deal came from. So we actually didn't have to leave the Grobs to get a record deal.
Pi would be looking for punk bands. Every record label needed a couple of punk bands. Jock said that he would stay in the band to help them get a deal, but then once they were going full time, he didn't want to know.
Jock went through a big agony of indecision about should he go with them or should he not. He had a decent career just starting to get underway, so do you risk all that to go on the road with a punk rock band or not? So I know he went hot and cold on the idea in both directions, but eventually he decided not to go for that option.
We could say as well that they never truly replaced Jock. He was the heartbeat of the band in a lot of ways. Second trip to the birthplace of punk, the Roxy Club, in March, I think it was, 1978. I ran a bus trip to that gig. So that was great fun in itself. I remember booking the bus and saying, you were going to London. Oh, what for? I'd see some music. Oh, where about are you going? Covent Garden. And the guy said, oh, Covent Garden, a bit of opera. And I said, yeah, that kind of thing. That's the kind of thing, yeah. So that guy's face dropped when he drove around the corner of the station to see sort of 40 punk rockers in various states of disarray waiting to get on the bus. In July, 19th of July, I think, 1978, at the Marquee Club, which, again, what an amazing club. You know, steeped in the history of British music, and to play there and go down the storm, play really well, have a big following, that was another one that definitely springs to mind as a highlight.
We recorded our album at Pye Studios in the Edgware Road in London. I mean, the bands that recorded there, well, we were. I mean, the Kinks, Quo. At one point, Bowie was signed to Pye Records in 61, 62. So he recorded down there. There was a point where Bob was doing the vocals and it wasn't going too well, and the producer was getting a bit edgy. And unfortunately, the producer told Bob to shut up. And Bob came up the steps, hit the door, smashed into the wall. And I wish I'd had a camera with expressions on the faces of the engineer and producer. Complete and utter fear. He just, don't you ever tell me to shut up. Oh my God, here we go.
Understand the reason. My teacher told me to have a better than one. Yeah, there's money was bad, but that was only one green. Yeah, the only time I seen it's in the football team. One rainy day, I try to make a living. To go out my face, yeah, out my face with a chance that's better. If I try to break green, you're gonna have a tree. Since I try and die, yeah, there's a real big tree. So it's all over the top. You can see what it's like on the other side. So it's all over the top and out of your trenches. You can see what it's like.
When we signed to them, it wasn't quite so credible, perhaps. In the adjacent studio, a smaller studio next door, we heard who was in there. We went and said hello to Jim Henson mixing the latest Muppets album. Bob went into the toilets for Pete, and there was a pair of shiny black patent leather shoes sort of showing just under the cubicle door in the toilet. It was Des O'Connor, who was in there Monday morning to record his new album. We'd started to think, oh, have we signed to the right company here? I mean, the photographer, we did the photo shoot, and the photographer that Pi used, he said, oh, a couple of days ago I did a shoot with Brotherhood of Man. Anyway, we got the thing recorded. Basically, Pye didn't know what to do with us. We did the tour with the album and everything, up and down the country.
Yeah, that was about every night for 3 months, perhaps.
Yeah.
Two or three nights.
Yeah. Varying ups and downs in terms of the venues.
That's right, incredible, yeah, some of them were. You turn up and it's horrendous.
But we did a good one at Cheltenham Town Hall with Penetration, that's a good name.
Yeah.
Nashville Rooms with Punishment of Luxury. But we're pretty much headlining most of ourselves.
Yeah, there was a classic one at Whitley Bay where we drove up there and...
Oh God.
Flaiden fella said, well, do you want a fixed fee or do you want door taking? So he says, oh, we'll go for door taking. So we ended up driving back home with £3.50 or something.
While we're in the London area and playing London, we stayed at a place called the Madison Hotel in Sussex Gardens, Paddington, which is sort of a rock and roll hotel. And there was one night we were coming back in from a gig, and it was usual, we were full of beer and kebabs, and we got back and we were pretty up, and you know, and apparently staying there that night, the soul band Heatwave, who were quite a big band, you know, they had hits and being on top of the pops, and that night they headlined at Hammersmith Odeon. They complained about the noise to us and said they were trying to sleep. And we thought, God, if we'd headlined Hammersmith Odeon, we'd been partying for about 3 days. What's wrong with them? And why are they staying there, you know, with their money? And then next thing, recording wise, was Pye's Aqua Studios in Edgware Road.
Yeah.
In London, which is...
That was £50 an hour, and we got a far better sound in Pollen, didn't we?
Yeah, we weren't happy with the production at the end of it.
No, it didn't sound like...
It didn't last much longer. The guy signed us was on holiday in South Africa and got shot, so he was off the scene. We got a few record companies to come and see us, like Marquee and Dingwalls and National Rooms and places. Yeah. But I remember RCA coming to see us and said, yeah, we like the band, but we're not interested in the singer. Oh, okay, bye. Second album was recorded at Fairview.
Actually, it has some really good songs on it. In fact, I prefer it to the first record we did at Pye, to be quite honest. Yo, fashion crazy dogs are making me so dizzy. You're so busy, slow down a bit. I'm tired of it. Fashion feelers taking hold of sooner, but that it is something crazy. Woman, can't you see what you have done to me? And I think that went to Pye, and they decided not to go ahead with it. So basically, we played a few more gigs with that lineup, and we sort of decided to call it quits. Around that time, me and Bob were in the Grob and Duckets, and Kev Nixon and Steve Roberts came over, and Kev said, look, I've got a couple of songs. Do you want to, you know, go in with Steve on drums and just knock them out and see what they come out like? So I had Fireball. Your Old Man and The Mess I'm In. Your old man's got money in the Midland. I bet he's got a pretty penny put aside. And he's got gas for central heating. It keeps him warm when it's cold outside. And then around that time, Dave was doing tours with UK Subs. So he says, well, why don't you support the Subs on the tour to sort of promote this record to see, you know, what will happen with it. So I think Kev maybe just played one or two gigs with us with the Subs. We decided to quit.
So one night I met Dave Stewart. I think we were both fairly drunk. And I said to him, Dave, what's happening with the band? He said, oh, it's terrible. The bass player's left and we've got no bass player. And I was like, ooh. And he said, we've got a record coming out, no bass player to help promote it. Again, I was, you know, and we've got a tour coming up with the UK Subs. I'll do it. And finally got the message, and so that's how I ended up in Cyanide. Go take a trip along West Avenue to see the people enjoy the view. It's only down street a few hundred yards from the TV tower where they're giving my part to play. I had 5 days to learn the set and one rehearsal. And the first gig was at St George's Hall in Bradford, which is huge.
And Paul miraculously learned the set in about a week.
think the first gig was St George's Hall. I was looking for sort of like a big pub or something, because you know it's that massive building behind you. Oh my God.
So we got into the dressing room, and after a bit they said, okay, you're on. And this is absolutely true. We came out, we turned right, we turned left, we couldn't find the stage. It was straight out of Spinal Tap. We're all rock and roll, and you know, broom cupboard, everything, couldn't find it. Eventually we did obviously find it, and they said to me, right, Paul, you get ready to go on first, because you've got to go right to the other side of the stage. So I was like having a little peek through the curtain, and I was already nervous. In my head I was going, C, D, E, F, you know, what's the notes? And so looking out and seeing these like thousands of kids slightly freaked me out, and I turned around to say something to the others, and as you saw Bob throwing up with nerves, which didn't make me any better at all. But anyway, they said, that's it, you're on.
Right, the subs at Newcastle Mayfair. So we played, and then we were up on the balcony, if anybody knows the place. We did it leaper with the mixing desk. So the subs start the set, and then half a dozen songs into the set, Nick Garrett's guitar strap came off, and he just threw his guitar across the stage, turned around, bombshelled his Marshall stack, and then he actually picked up the drum riser, you know, the raised bit that the drum kit is on, and I picked it up, like, and Pete and the drum kit just slid off the back. It's a big pile at the back of the stage, and that was the end of the gig, basically, and the audience and us were all stood there looking stunned.
Fucking marvellous.
This really expensive looking camera bag that some scallywag nicked. He must have been really disappointed, because it wasn't full of camera gear, it was full of my socks and underpants. In his disgust, he'd thrown it onto the roof, and we saw it from this building, we saw it through this window, and the zipper opened as he'd twirled it across all my socks and underpants and scattered across this roof. And I threw a complete diva strop and said, how could I possibly go on without any underpants? Dave Leeper, to his eternal credit, says, I shall rescue your shreddies. And he crawled out of this window onto this roof. Bear in mind, it's winter, it's about 2 degrees below, and it's raining, it's icy, and it's a slopy roof, and it's well high. And we're all watching from the window, and he rescued all my knickers and socks and the bag. And I did think, as I was watching him, thinking, if he slips, what a strange obituary that's going to be. Rock band manager falls to his death rescuing bass players' trolleys.
Probably they got to the point where the Pinnacle record was probably their last punt. I mean, John Peel used to play it a bit. Used to play Your Old Man. Just didn't catch on.
Another Fireball, Your Old Man single. It sold a few, but it wasn't, obviously, things weren't really going anywhere.
And at that point, they were still great live. They had an absolute powerhouse of a drummer in the shape of Steve Roberts. But on the downside, I guess, there was the fact that they'd been slogging at this for 3 years now, probably getting on for 3 years, without much further progress, I suppose. And also, by then, you've got to remember that by 79, you know, punk had been going for years, and in 79 you had kind of a mod revival in full swing. The ska thing was massively just starting to happen. So maybe, you know, punk's commercial currency wasn't as high as it was either. It's such a shame. I often think, I wonder how things would have turned out had that first album had the power and production of the Fireball single. And then I think sort of finally Steve Roberts got an offer to join the UK subs, and that was probably the final nail in the the coffin.
So, obviously the band split up when Steve left.
I think the last gig was sort of December 1979 in London. It'll be the Music Machine.
So after the end of the tour with the UK Subs, it was winter, I remember, and we were all tired and depressed, and Steve had joined the UK Subs, so we were drummerless. So it was a case of, do we get another drummer and carry on, or is that it?
You know, various reasons kind of conspired to mean that time was up. But it had been a hell of a ride and we really enjoyed it. That, for me, is why he's the best frontman that this fair city has ever produced.
And it was difficult for him, you know. Because he looked big and broody, but he was a soft bear, big teddy bear.